Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.
And again, aided and abetted most competently by Brian Sedillo today. The election was yesterday. As we're recording this, Brian and I are recording this. The election was Tuesday. This is a Wednesday. And so I would simply say, in my view, as a result of the election, the response from the people of New Jersey should be...
Bohica, Bohica, bend over, here it comes, Bohica, Bohica, again.
Look out! Yeah, they got us again. You're going to see absolutely no change, except the possibility that the public workers' unions will be... probably, you know, get their head a little deeper into the trough, and some talk of some other progressive moves in the state. But again, sadly, these two parties, it's two sides of the same coin. Not much is going to happen there. So that's my commentary on the election. The only thing that interested me at all was Senator Lesniak's public question about the... dedicating the money that comes out of ExxonMobil for pollution.
Right.
So was there any, Brian, do you know, you work, of course, in the morning show.
Uh-huh.
Was there any talk about the turnout? Was the turnout of any particular interest one way or the other?
No, not really. No.
Yeah.
It was pretty straightforward.
So, I mean, there's no like huge turnout or no lowest in history turnout.
It was about 30%, I believe. Yeah.
Well, anyway, it's over. A few more thoughts on that maybe coming up. To get to the point here, the text, I guess, of my sermon today could be called Carton Revisited or Karma Bites Butt, depending on how you look at this. There was a writer at one time named Alexander King, and he was a gentleman of considerable years, but of great charm. He used to be a regular guest on the old Jack Parr Tonight Show. That was before Johnny Carson, Jack Parr, did the show. Alexander King wrote a book called Mine Enemy Grows Older. Mm. And I was thinking maybe the subtext here today would be Mine Enmity Grows Older. Because my longtime nemesis here at the radio station was indicted on Friday by a New York grand jury for, in order... conspiracy to commit wire fraud, conspiracy to commit securities fraud, wire fraud, securities fraud, and running a multimillion dollar Ponzi scheme. He will appear next in court to enter what his lawyers say is going to be a not guilty plea. Mm-hmm. He and his lawyers say that he's just a poor innocent lamb who somehow got tied up with the wrong people. Fell in with a bad crowd. And it used to be back in the old days when you were a kid, if that happened, you know, you've been caught stealing hubcaps, not $3 million from investors. So you can see how the times have changed. It's sort of upscaled. But the reports say that he did it to cover some $3 million in bad gambling debts. Now, that, again, is according to reports. And being at the mercy of gamblers is not the most comfortable place to be. Yeah. They have a habit of wanting to collect their debt, and sometimes with enthusiasm. Mm. So even if you owed Mother Teresa $3 million, it's got to be very uncomfortable. And $3 million owed to people who no doubt have considerable interest in getting it back. And I begin at that moment to weaken my stance a little bit and say, that's one heck of a bind for a person to be in. What would I do? And then I saw a story that listed his base salary. Now, of course, people in broadcasting often will get outside work, commercial work and the like. But the base salary at the radio station, although healthy, it was certainly not huge.
Right.
And I did a little bit of simple math. If he took his entire income at that basic salary level, all of it, and paid it off the gambling debts, it would take him 15 years. And after taxes, it would be about 22 years.
Wow.
And I did confess feeling a flash of sympathy for him. I've gone in before about how he spent a couple of years here, totally unmercifully on my case, bashing me, trying to get me, you know, off the air for no reason. I never met him, never met him, never said anything about him, don't know him. But somehow he got hung up on that. But that's another story. It probably would take a team, a couple teams of Freuds working around the clock to figure out how some of these minds work. But this would impose one heck of an impossible load to get dumped in your lap. Now, I won't moralize about the gambling. Mm. That is another matter that may be. But there's no indication that his gambling was illegal.
Right.
I mean, I've not heard, Brian, have you heard anything?
I haven't heard anything.
I mean, he wasn't like into the mob. So his kneecaps are safe.
Right.
For the moment.
Yeah.
Anyway, he won't be walking around like Toulouse-Lautrec, I guess, when he gets back or wherever he's going. But it's would be, try to feel how it would be to get yourself in a pickle like that, especially if you got a family, yeah, which Dennis tells me that he does. I have never met them either, of course. So he's charged now, not with that gambling debt. That's a side issue in a sense, but the activity that he chose to dig his way out of it. And I thought, you can't help but think a little bit of the old thing there, but for the grace of God go I. Mm. Sort of. Though I can't imagine going down that particular road. Mm. There was a parallel in a sense. Remember Leonard Tose,
yeah,
Brian?
Mm-hmm.
He was a very wealthy trucking magnate who owned the Philadelphia Eagles. Well,
yep,
he got into trouble with the Atlantic City casinos.
Yep.
And there's a long lawsuit and went on. But eventually, the thing of it is, he could pay it off. Mm-hmm. But this was at the cost of everything he had, and he ended up going broke. But at least he paid off the debt.
Yeah.
He's walking upright. Knees are in fine shape, far as I know. But had he been unable to pay it, or think, if I owed that, what would you do? You might actually, thoughts might turn to something that would be, a little bit out of the mainstream ethical way of behavior. But unhappily and tragically, of course, the person in that boat, he drags the family along with him, which is, you know, as he moves into the heart of darkness here, wherever it's going. Mm. But I thought actually the there but for the grace of God bit does make some sense after all. All right, that's what I thought. Then I noticed yesterday that he had given an interview with, was it USA Today?
I think so.
I didn't read it, but I saw Asbury Park Press carried a synopsis
of
it. And here he is again back trashing people in his usual demeaning style. And this time it was, I think he mentioned Geno Smith.
Geno Smith, yeah.
Who was a backup quarterback for the Giants. Apparently he's been on Geno's case.
Mm.
But it would seem to me that if you are maliciously trying to trash someone, to destroy their reputation, because even though they're probably doing the best they can, and I don't doubt that the quarterback is doing the best he can, he may not have the God-given talents that would meet the haughty standards of Carton. But I think to do that is a deplorable, despicable thing. And especially maybe because you have absolutely no talent yourself in that in that particular field, which I have somehow suspected. I use this a lot, and I can't help but think of it again. Mary Shelley's great line in the Frankenstein novel, where the monster is confronted by Victor Frankenstein, who created him, and the monster's been on a real tear, a rampage, and Victor Frankenstein says, why are you so malicious? And the monster says, well, I am malicious because I am miserable. And so I thought, that makes sense. So if malice and misery can be equalized there, then this guy must be some really miserable, unhappy person. But perhaps karma, because he has done that. And of course, I, as I said, I was the butt of it. he did a particularly really vicious, nasty job on Mrs. Cody, who was a thoroughly admirable, in my view, a great person, the wife of the former governor. And this is for no particular reason, out of, I hate to use the cliche, but mean-spiritedness. And so the if karma has any validity, maybe this is what's working there. You know, the wheel has rather spun around. But mercilessly trashing and demeaning people for no discernible cause at all. I would have to say, well, I guess maybe karma owes this guy a very large bite out of his rear end. And we will let it go at that. We will see what happens. It's a very interesting story to follow.